to welcome you all to the 5-day online faculty development program by AICTE, Training and Learning Academy, on nature-inspired optimization techniques. Today, we have the fourth session on an interactive introduction to particle swarm optimization by Dr. Anupam Yadav. I would like to start by giving a brief introduction of Dr. Anupam Yadav. Sir is an assistant professor in the Department of Mathematics at Dr. B.R. Ambedkar National Institute of Technology, Jalandhar. He has more than 10 years of research experience in areas of soft computing and optimization. Dr. Yadav has done a PhD in soft computing from the Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, and he has worked as a research professor at Korea University. He has published more than 25 research articles in journals of international repute, some of which I have listed in the tab just adjacent in the presentation. He has published more than 15 research articles in conference proceedings. Dr. Yadav has authored a textbook entitled An Introduction to Neural Network Methods for Differential Equations. He has also edited 3 books, which are published by the AISC Springer series. Dr. Yadav was the general chair, convener, and the member of steering committee and the member of steering committees of several international conferences. He is also a member of various research societies. The research interests include evolutionary computation, artificial intelligence, optimization, data science. The area of research is focused on the design and analysis of the nature-inspired optimization algorithms. Currently, he is working in the areas of artificial intelligence and data science. Sir, we are delighted to have you here. I'd like to hand over the presentation to you now.
Thank you, Aditya, for this introduction. If I'm audible, Dr. Vivek, yes. I'm starting. Just confirm me if I'm audible.
Yes,
sir, you're audible.
Okay. Thank you so much. So, as the title says, we are going to see a very interactive introduction of particle swarm optimization. Let me share the slides. Okay. So, Aditya, can you confirm if the slides are visible?
Yes, sir, okay.
They are visible.
Okay, so we are set to go. So yesterday I got to know that you already had some idea about PSO. Before we start this particular session, let me first tell you what you can anticipate and expect out of this lecture, because most of you are. Majority of you must be belonging to engineering background. So most of the time we just remain as a user of these kind of techniques, whether it's a PSO, GA, or many more algorithms under the same umbrella. But in this session, what we are going to address, what are the features and factors which makes this PSO working efficient for certain problems. And how come we can understand the mathematical aspects that this is the thing which makes this PSO slightly different over other algorithms. And this is the working procedure and manner in which this PSO algorithm has been designed. So that is why I named the title of this session as a PSO and interactive introduction. So let me start with the very basic problem, and then we'll quickly move towards more technical and mathematical contents. But let us first try to understand the philosophy behind population-based search algorithm, because PSO is one of the population-based search algorithm. So before learning any population-based search algorithm, it has a worth to understand how this population-based algorithms came into an existence and how they are doing so well. So let me pose you a very simple problem which we need to address here. Suppose we are living in a world which is say 1000 years or 1200 years back, And there is a very simple problem with us. From that problem, the idea is to get the insight of the philosophy of population-based search algorithm. Suppose there is some water area, you can say it's a pond or a certain region of a river, where the objective is to figure out the deepest point in that particular region. That region you can call from the current scenario, like the search region or the constraint region where we are looking for the solution. So what is the problem? In this simple language, it's the problem where we are expecting to locate the point of interest, which is the deepest point, suppose it's a pond. So why the deepest point? Because we may believe that the, there may be some treasure in a form of fishes or other stones where it may be lying in the deepest point. So that is why our interest is to locate that deepest point. Mathematically, we can call it as a global minima in this particular region. So, but since we are living 1200 years back, we don't have modern equipments which can do or measure the depth of any place in below the water. So what would be the possible solution if we are living in that era? So one of the possible solution is to cut a bamboo tree, long enough bamboo tree, and take a ship or a very small ship and keep on measuring the depth of the pond at different locations. So in this way, you will create a information. And if you keep on doing this kind of exercise for a significant amount of time, and if the region is not very large, you may be able to locate that point of interest, which is the deepest point. But since we did this thing with only one ship, but if we do the same thing, but with a different strategy, and what would be that strategy? That strategy would be, instead of working with a single ship, if we come up with a multiple ships and try to do the same thing what we were doing with a single ship, and in the meantime we keep on sharing the information as well. Like suppose one of the ship has measured the depth at a particular point, so it keep on shout to the other ship and it can inform him that this at this location this is the deepest point. So one can easily understand from this phenomenon, if we keep on working with a single ship, it may take a significant amount of time, or it may take very large amount of time to get our point of interest. But if we do with this collective approach, then we may be able to get the same point of interest with more efficiency and in less amount of time. So this is the social philosophy and phenomenon of population-based search technique. The first strategy was the strategy where only single worker was there, single candidate solution was there. If I talk in terms of algorithm, only single candidate solution was there who was trying to discover our point of interest. But in the later case, what was happening? We were trying to achieve the same point of interest, but with a set of candidate solutions, which we call as a population. So this is the more or less philosophy behind any population-based search algorithm. The way we create information sharing strategy, how we transfer the information, how we collect the intellect, that defines the particular strategies. It may be GA, genetic algorithm, it may be particle swarm optimization, it may be differential evolution, it may be gravitational search algorithm, it may be artificial bee colony. There, information sharing and movement behavior varies from one idea to another idea, but their overall objective is this original framework which I just explained. So this was just I wanted to take a few minutes to make a background so that we can understand before learning any population-based search algorithm what basically is we should meant by population-based search algorithm. So now come to this nature inspired algorithms scenario. PSO is one of them. We have many nature inspired optimization algorithms. PSO is one of them. And the inspiration of PSO has come from how collectively school of fish works, how birds flock from one place to another place to locate their food or their point of interest. So in PSO, what their founders have tried to do, they have tried to mimic the behavior of how fish school does, or how the birds in a collection flock from one place to another place to locate their point of interest. So this is the natural inspiration for PSO, from where the originators of this algorithm has taken the very first insight. These were the two. These are two persons who are responsible for the development of the very first version of PSO, Russell Eberhard and James Kennedy. Now, let us try to change the gear very swiftly and try to understand the mathematical aspect of this algorithm. I already told you what were the natural inspirations for the development of this particle swarm optimization, fish school, birds flock, or other natural phenomenon which we can observe in nature. But what personally I believe, this kind of structure has been existing from a very long, long time. We have only modified in a very, very minute way. We'll try to understand what we have modified. So in the present slide, you must be able to see a very famous iterative scheme, which is used to find the root of any given mathematical function. It's a very popular, I'm sure all of you must have read it or understand it or used it while studying in your undergrad mathematics classes. So what it does, first let us try to understand this method very, very briefly, and then we'll try to connect this PSO scheme, how it is related with this idea why I'm showing this particular slide. So if you carefully observe this particular method, so what is happening in this method? You have been given a function for which you are trying to find out its root. Finding a root of a function or minimizing a function, both of the things are actually parallel, or one can say both of them are equivalent. If I am finding a root of a function, same thing I can model as an optimization problem. So it's not a much difference, only the perspective of viewing it is different. So what this method does, it has a scheme. I'll not go into the details how this scheme has been designed, but I'll explain how this scheme works. So it has an iterative scheme, which you can see on your screen. And how we use it, we provide an initial guess.
Not visible. Only title slide is visible. Slides are not changing, sir.
Dr. Vivek, is it the case?
No, sir, it's visible. Slide number 5.
Yeah, I'm on slide number 5.
Yes, correct, sir.
Okay, I think the particular participant, you just to try to recheck your connectivity, or just press escape button and come again. It must be some technical glitch because others are able to see. So yes, I was on this iterative scheme. So what we need to do while executing this scheme, we need to provide an initial guess. And how we choose that initial guess? We have certain mathematical ideas that we need to guess, or guess an interval or region where our root is lying. And we can choose a random point nearest to the exact root. Sometimes that guess may be very suitable for this scheme. Sometimes it may not be. So this method, depending on the function for which you are trying to find the root, and what is the initial guess you have taken, the success of this method also depends on these two factors as well. So you see this kind of system where we are figuring out a particular point of interest with the help of an iterative scheme already existed in our literature from a very, very long time. So what you do, you provide an initial guess. Suppose, for example, it's X naught, which is the initial guess. And then we can process this X naught into this scheme. It will provide you X1, again, process X1 into the same scheme. It will give you X2. So recursively we are using, and what we are anticipating in terms of X0, X1, X2, X3, and so on, we are basically creating a trajectory of candidate solutions in an ideal situation. It should converge towards our point of interest, which is the root of this particular function. So you see here, what we are creating generation. We are creating a generation which constitutes a trajectory of candidate solutions, and it is going towards our point of interest. So similar kind of iterative scheme we follow in PSO-like algorithms as well. The only difference is in Newton-Raphson-like scheme, we are only moving with a single candidate solution. On the other hand, in PSO, differential evaluation, or GA, or any another algorithm in this similar bracket, we are moving with a set of candidate solutions or a population of solutions. So how we can create an influence into that population so that they can fetch our point of interest, that makes a particular algorithm what we call it. So personally, what I believe, before developing these kind of algorithm, these kind of methods must have been a source of inspiration as well while developing this population based search algorithm, which is actually a extension and enhancement where we were moving with a single candidate solution, but now we are moving with a population of solutions. So this is the major difference between these population based search algorithms. Particularly now we'll talk about PSO only, because this session is focused on PSO. So classical method starts with a single rough solution and a collection of initial solutions are chosen to do the similar job, and that is what we call it as a population based search technique. So I have actually created a very interactive PPT which will help us to understand the modus operandi of PSO. So this was the same Newton-Raphson method, and the difference between the classical methods and the population-based techniques: single solution, classical methods, and a population of candidate solutions, modern techniques like PSO, GA, and other things. So its inspiration we have been already saw, or you might have been already saw it in previous addresses as well. So now come to this particular landscape. This is a very famous mathematical function. In the end of the slide, I'll reveal its name. Many of you might be knowing its mathematical name. Why we are saying this function? Because we can easily observe that we can see several peaks and drops in this particular landscape of this particular function. So suppose we have an interest to figure out the minimum point of this function or the global minimum of this function. So by just simply observing this landscape, one can easily conclude that this point is actually the least point or the minimum value of this particular landscape for which has been created by using some mathematical function. So we are going to learn from this landscape how this PSO, which is a population based search algorithm, actually helps to discover this particular point of interest, which is this particular point in this current scenario. The same thing we can do if we are looking for the maximum point, then our point of interest would be this particular peak. So two things must be in our mind while proceeding. What makes this problem challenging? the problem in this particular scenario is actually challenging because there are not only global minimas, there are local maxima and local minimas as well in this particular landscape. So what is the problem with population-based search algorithms? If they are dealing with this kind of situation, there is a chance that they might locate undervalued solution. Undervalued solutions means they can return me, for example, this particular point as a solution, but in reality, which is not the solution. So the quality and optimization ability of any population-based search algorithm also depends on this fact that whether they are able to statistically, most of the times, whether they are able to locate the global optimal solution or not. So we'll take this Newton-Raphson scheme as a base to actually create the overall working procedure of particle swarm optimization so that we can easily understand in a very easy language why actually this PSO kind of algorithm is working for many problems and how it has been created. So like a Newton-Raphson method, what we were supposed to do there, we were supposed to create an initial guess, and that has to be done by randomly generating a solution or randomly guessing a particular point which might be near to the root of the function. So in this case, when we are dealing with PSO kind of algorithm, what we need to do, we need to also create random candidate solutions in a specified boundary. That boundary may be termed as a search region where we are looking for the minima or maxima of any given function. So here what is important, because the candidate solutions, they are going to be deployed in the domain of the function. Many times while understanding the PSO theory, students do get confusion that the particles are generated on the landscape or on the function value. But function value is only just a value. But their location is the place where we are actually interested. So in this picture, two things should be very clear in our mind. The value which are lying on this landscape, these are the functional values. They are the functional values, the values at the locations in the domain. So this rectangular region in the plane where axis is represented between -4 to 4, basically this is -4, -4, -4, -4. This is creating this cuboid kind of scene. So in this particular plane, -4, -4, -4, this is going to be work as a search region. Means this is the region where we are going to look for the minimum value of this particular landscape. So first, when we identified the search region where we are looking the optimal solution, then in that search region, which we can call mathematically as a domain as well, in that domain we need to randomly generate the candidate solutions. So let us move towards the domain of the function. So suppose this is the domain of the function and landscape is on top of this particular plane. So what we need to do, we need to randomly generate certain positions. In PSO, we call them as a particle, but fundamentally they are just locations. How we can generate these number of candidate solutions, we'll see later on by using random function available in all programming platforms. You can easily create these candidate solutions without much effort. So far what we have reached, we have got a landscape or a mathematical function for which we are looking for its minimum. And what we did, we have generated some workers for us, which we are calling here as a candidate solutions, or in PSO we call them as a particle. But in population, in all the population based algorithms, these locations are in a standard form, we can call them as a candidate solutions. For example, in PSO, the inventors call them as a particle, so it is famous with particle. If you go with the gravitational search algorithm, the inventors of that algorithm termed them as a agents, so they are called agents, but fundamentally they are simply candidate solutions, or in a more fundamental way, they are just location in the search region. So when we are having these workers, particles, or candidate solutions with us, now we need to create communication strategy among these particles or candidate solutions so that they can communicate to each other and they can share their valuable information stored with them. So two things I mentioned here. One is create an information sharing strategy. How we can do that, we'll see it. And then share the valuable information with them, which is stored with them. So what is that valuable information? So two types of information or two types of knowledge, it is naturally available with all of these candidate solutions. And what are those ideas and knowledge which these candidate solutions having? The position means when we are creating these or generating these particles, we know where they are locating. So if we know where they are locating, their location is stored with us. It may be in a form of an array, or it may be stored in a form of a matrix. So when we'll see the programming aspect of this one, it will be very clear. Before finishing this session, I'll give you a very easiest available code for PSO, which I have created for understanding point of view, where you can easily understand all these aspects which I'm explaining here. So two types of information, the location, which I'm calling as a position, and their functional value. What is functional value? Again, recall the function which we are minimizing, that landscape. Its mathematical function is with us. So what we can do, we can pass these locations into that particular functional value. And then what we can do, we can evaluate it and we can have the functional value of all of the positions. So these kind of two informations, they are naturally available with these landscapes. Now what to do? So when we evaluated the functional value of all these positions, we will be having an array of or a set of functional values. Means, for example, what is the functional value of this location, this location, this location? Suppose there are n number of particles. So we have an array of length n, which includes the functional value or fitness value of each and every these located candidate solutions. So what will happen when we carefully observe that particular array? Because these locations are located at different places, so their functional value will also be different, because it's not a constant function which we are optimizing. So what we can do, we can simply sort that array, or you can simply find out which one is the minimum in that particular array. So what will happen? Suppose we sorted out and we figure out that this red flagged position is actually having the least functional value among all these generated candidate solutions. Okay, so three informations are already with us: the location of all these candidate solutions, the functional value, and one more additional information just we have discovered, that out of all these candidate solutions, this location is having the least function value. It may not be a global optimal or optimal solution, but so far it is actually the best among this particular candidate solutions. Okay, so what to do with this candidate solution? Since it is best in this particular swarm or in this particular population, so let us give it a name that we are calling it as a global best. Global best means in a current population, this is the location or this is the particle which is having the least fitness value. So far, this is the best located position. So we are calling it as a global best. But that global best may not be the global optimal solution. It has to be very clear in our minds. Now, what to do further? So now our objective and prospective would be in such a way so that we can improve the locations of these candidate solutions. When I say improve the location, it means we need to perform the iteration. Recall the Newton-Raphson method. It was moving from x0 to x1. So what it was doing, it was basically improving the quality of solution, means reducing the error. So the same thing we would like to do here as well. In Newton-Raphson method, we were doing with a single candidate solution, but here we are doing the similar kind of job, but with a population of solutions. So what would be the possible ideas to improve the, for example, suppose if I pick this one and I wanted to improve its accuracy, means, for example, it is locating a particular functional value and it has to actually go towards the global optimal solution. This is its ultimate objective. For actually all of them have the ultimate objective to locate that global optimal solution, which is, if I go back and show you that particular slide again, so this one, all these candidate solutions are basically in this domain and their ultimate objective is to locate this particular point, which is the global optimal solution for this particular function. So how can they do these things so that they can achieve their point of interest? So now here I will discuss the strategies which were coined by the inventors of PSO. I'll take small general life examples so that we can understand easily. Suppose it is a class, it is a classroom, and this is a student who is scoring good marks or the best marks in this entire class. And suppose this is me, and I also want to improve my performance in the next examination. So what should I do? What should be my strategy so that in the next example, at least I should perform well what I have done just now? So of course, the fundamental ideas are I should study more, I should study hard, I should make some planning, and accordingly, these are the very subjective ideas which one can think immediately in his or her mind. But what is the idea this particular candidate solution can get from this entire population? One of the ideas is, why not to follow the person or a student who is actually doing better than me? For example, this red flagged particle is actually having a better position, or it is having a better marks than this one. So why not to follow this one? So in this way, what will happen? I may not get my ultimate objective, but at least what will happen if I am following the strategies followed by this particular red flag particle, at least what I can expect, I will improve. This is what this particular candidate solution can expect if it follows what strategy is being followed by this red flagged particle. Same thing can do rest of the class as well, or rest of the swarm as well. Why not to follow the person or the particle which is actually having a better location than me? But there is a drawback. Be very careful at this point of time. Suppose all of them are only following this particular candidate solution. So what will happen if I follow this strategy as the only strategy? All of them will gather at this location, and what will happen? We'll get a premature convergence, means we'll not get the global optimal solution or the acceptable optimal solution, and we will all finish and end up at this particular location. So the idea which I just explained, it is good up to some extent, but we cannot solely dependent on this idea only, because if I am only following this one, what would be my ultimate end up? I will end up like him. But and I already know that this particular guy is actually also not the best among globally. It is best among us, but it is not best globally. So this is the first idea these particles are employing to improve their position, to follow the best available in the swarm. So let's understand this whole scenario. Means this slide is going to explain how the first iteration of particle swarm optimization is going to happen. So I picked up typical particle. I just picked one of them from entire swarm, and we would like to understand here how this particular candidate solution is going to make its first move, or in terms of algorithm, how the first iteration is going to happen. The way it will happen with this particular candidate solution, the same thing will be applied to the entire solution. And when this entire thing will be completed, we will be having our first iteration completed. So let's very carefully try to understand how it is going to make its first move, this particular candidate solution. So since we have to do it on a programming platform, so we need to store these candidate solution in certain variables. So let us mark as a capital X. So this location is stored in capital X, and this T stands for time. It means at time T, this is the location, because we are going to follow iterations, and we are expecting that in every iteration these candidate solutions will change. So this time will be the variable which will tell us at this particular time this is the location. So it is actually 2x2 environment, so you can see its location like somewhere it is 2.5 comma minus somewhere between minus 3 comma 4. This is the location how it will be stored in actuality when you will be doing or implementing this algorithm. So now let's understand how this is going to make its first move. So this particular inference, this is nothing but the vector difference of this g best t minus xt, means the location of this minus this. So this is nothing but the influence. This vector will actually implicating that let's move towards this. Okay, so it means what? If you add g best minus xt to xt, what will happen? You will get g best. Again, I'm repeating. If you add g best minus xt to this location that is stored in xt, what will happen? You will get g best. So this is how it is making its move. So, but I already cautioned you. If I'm going to follow this strategy only, I'm going to end up at this location only, and I may not get the point where we have been actually plan to go. So this is one strategy I have noted down, but I am going to follow one more strategy so that we can maintain some diversity as well, so that we should not end up in some premature convergence. So what is the another strategy? Another strategy is, while initializing or randomly generating these candidate solutions, what we have given some velocity to these positions, that at a certain time t this particle is moving with this velocity. So one of the strategy I can follow, that why not to follow my own instinct? Again, go back to check the same classroom example. Suppose I already give one strategy, that why not to follow the student who is doing actually well in the entire swarm or in the entire class. That is one of the strategy. One of the strategy could be to follow my own instinct. Why not to follow the way I'm doing? It may not be doing good, but it is also a strategy. So in this particular first iteration, what we are going to do, we are going to combine these two strategies. One of the strategy is to follow the global best, which is doing the best among the swarm. And another is to follow the own instinct, that is called the own velocity factor. In PSO, we call it as a own velocity factor. For example, with this candidate solution, which is at a location xt, if I am not using this influence g best minus xt, so what it will happen, it will keep on moving in this particular direction, which is shown here as a vt. So what we'll do, instead of following either this way or this way, let us take the combination of both and take the sum of these two influences. And what will happen, so what would be the impact? I will not end up either here or here. I will end up somewhere here, which is this particular location, which this candidate solution has discovered by employing the joint influence of global best and the this own velocity. So this is how the very first iteration of this particular candidate solution or particle is going to happen. And it is now locating somewhere here, which is stored as a xt plus 1. Or you can say at a time t plus 1 or in the next iteration. Same thing we'll do for the entire population. So what will happen? Entire population will be iterated and all the positions will be in a different locations. Okay, so in this slide, what it is reflecting, these are suppose the initial locations of initially generated particles or candidate solutions. And after performing the first iteration, I already explained how we perform the first iteration, they are actually locating these locations. Okay, so this candidate solution moved here, this candidate solution moved here, this candidate moved solution here, this candidate solution moved here. For only understanding point of view, I have taken only four particles here, but it is understood that this kind of phenomenon has happened with the entire population, and the entire population is getting got updated and they have discovered the new locations. What are the qualities of those locations? There is a point of concern, we'll see. But so far what we have done, we have performed our first iteration of PSO and the entire population is iterated from one location to another location. So here at this point of time, we have one more strategy to be included, which is called as a personal best. For example, if I take this particular candidate solution, what is happening? It is taking position from here to here. So I can evaluate its functional value and I can compare whether this one is a better or this one is better. So what will happen? Basically, what is happening and going on, if you recall the example of Newton-Raphson method, we are creating a trajectory of solutions. In Newton-Raphson method, there was only one trajectory, but in PSO, for each and every initial generated candidate solution, it is actually creating a generation of solutions. So in each and every generation, we have an opportunity to compare whether the candidate solution is better in a present generation or it is better in previous generation. So this is how we can understand the concept of personal best. So now again, come back to this picture where it is solely going to understand and explain how a typical iteration or a general iteration of PSO can be performed, where all the influences which are available in PSO are available. So two of the influences I have already discussed. The first one is the global best one. So if I'm following the global best one, I will end up somewhere here. If I'm following my own velocity, I will end up somewhere here. But now, since I have already performed one iteration, so I can compare or take this p best minus xt influence. Why not to follow the own personal best? So in the first iteration, we had only two influences to incorporate, the global best one and the own velocity. But when first iteration is completed, we have one more aspect to include, and that is the personal best. So that is what we can do here. we can follow this strategy, second personal best strategy, and the own velocity strategy. And again, what we'll do to maintain the diversity and avoid the stagnation at a suboptimal point, what we'll do, we'll take the joint influence of all these three influences. That is the global best one, the personal best one, and the own velocity one. And how it can be done? It can be done by using the scalar or linear combination of this personal global best, personal best component, and the velocity component. And that can be seen like here, like this. So this is actually, these are two equations which are fundamentally responsible for iteration of each and every candidate solution in every iteration. So let me explain all these things again. We have already coined and explained each and every aspect, but let me reconnect everything once more. So if I see this first equation, which is called the velocity update equation, so it has actually a linear sum, a linear combination of three components: Vt, which was the own velocity, and P best minus Xt, this is the personal best strategy or personal best component, and this is the G best minus Xt, this is the global best influence. So to maintain the diversity, what inventors of this algorithm did, they took the linear combination of all these three influences into a single equation so that they can maintain diversity and utilize the goodness of each and every component, so that overall in totality this algorithm should work in a best possible way. So you can here see some multiple factors as well, like in the first component we have W, or we can call it omega as well, C1 C2. So these are basically parameters of this velocity update equation. They are just pinned here so that we can control each and every component. By tuning the value of this W, we can control this velocity component. By tuning the value of C1, we can control the personal best component, and by tuning the value of C2, we can control the component of global best one. So these W, C1 and C2, basically what they provide us a radio knob kind of thing, where we can tune it to get the best out of this PSO algorithm. What would be the best possible numerical values of W, C1, C2, we'll see it later. But theoretically, we should understand that these W, C1, C2 are actually the amplifying factors for VT, personal best component, and the global best component. If you wanted to enhance or increase the influence of particular component, just increase its scalar value and it will increase. So this first equation is called the velocity update equation. In every iteration, we are going to calculate the velocity of each and every candidate solution, and then it will be applied to the position, and recursively we are going to follow these two equations, and it will lead towards our point of interest, and we need to fix some stopping criterion when this algo needs to get executed. So this was basically the modus operandi and working procedure of the very first introduced particle swarm optimization. Here I have collected a video which is showing you the real time movement of these particles on this similar function. So you see here, the red one is the global best one, and rest of the particles, the blue one is the general, and the green one is the personal best of them. So let me play it once more. So see, in this the kind of strategy I have explained following this one, for this particular problem, it is actually able to locate the global optimal solution of this particular problem in only less than 50 iterations. So this was the this was all fundamentals, how PSO has been developed by its inventors, and what are the factors which are working inside PSO algorithm, and how it has been developed. And I'm sure if you have followed carefully, you must be able, what are the influences pinned in this PSO algorithm they are working, for which this algorithm is designed. So this is a flow chart of PSO. For programming point of view, we should start with a initialization of random position and velocity in the search region, then evaluate the fitness value, then compare update fitness value, personal best and global best, then fix a stopping criterion. When it meets, the program will execute and keep on updating the velocity and position in every iteration. So this was the this interactive explanation of PSO. I'm sure it must be helpful to you, those who actually wanted to understand the inside working phenomenon of PSO, not only with theory, how in practicality how it is basically working. So this is the life of a particle, how it moves from first generation, second generation, and final generation. And in these generations, we keep on figuring out which one is actually the personal best. And when you are trying to implement this algorithm and try to understand how we can identify the personal best and global best, so I have created this table where you can understand. In the first iteration, this is the population P11, P21, P31 to P71. These are the positions which stored the locations. In the second iteration, they are updated, like P11 moved to P12, P21 moved to P22. In this way, P13, P14, P15, and so on, up to the given number of iterations. So what if I need to identify the personal best, what I need to do? I need to simply just follow the first row, because first row is basically the trajectory of the first candidate solution. Similarly, second row is the trajectory of second candidate solution, and so on. So just figure out the minimum so far located minimum position. If you are solving minimization problem, that will locate you the personal best of first particle, and do the same thing for the second row. It will locate the personal best of the second particle, and so on. And global best is actually the best, which is best among all the particles in a particular iteration. For example, suppose P31 in the first iteration has the least value, so it will be the global best. Similarly, so just apply the min function row wise, it will lead you towards the personal best, and apply the min function column wise, it will lead you to the global best. So this is the very simple explanation how you can identify personal best and global best. This is again the similar kind of thing. If it follows own direction, it will lead here. It follows personal best, it will lead here. It follows global best, it will lead here. But in reality, we are incorporating all these three influences together. So what will happen? It will locate a fourth point, which will be the actual identification of this PSO algorithm. This is scheme I already explained you. W, C1, C2 are the parameter values. And there is not a fixed and declared best value for the these W, C1 and C2. While doing an experiment, you need to tune it. But for majority of the problems in literature, the value of W 0.7, C1, C2 near by under root 2, which is 1.47, they have been found suitable for which to handle many of the problems. But again, I'll emphasize on that whenever you are dealing or solving any problem using PSO, you need to tune them. Here, before I move ahead, I'd like to explain the rule of W or omega here once more, because I have mentioned here the value of W is a 0.7. If you carefully observe here, W is a multiple of Vt. So what is happening in every iteration, if you carefully observe, so this is basically a recurrence relation. If you mathematically observe it, this is nothing but a recurrence relation. So what is happening, it is in every step, it is keep on summing its previous value. So if you enhance the W value of W more than one, so what will happen? It will give the bigger amount of velocity component. So what will happen when you apply this calculated velocity component on position, it will give you bigger jumps. So if you wanted a bigger jump, just keep on increasing the value of W. But be careful, if you make the value of W more than one, then if you understand the concept of recurrence relation and their convergence, then it is going to create a divergence sequence. And there is going to be a most likely situation that your elbow may not converge towards a point of interest if the value of W is specifically more than one, because then this sequence is going to be a divergent sequence. Now let's try to understand the role and aspect of these factors. There are two things which we need to understand here. One is diversification and intensification. Diversification means we would like to explore the given search region in a most possible way. When I say most possible way, means if the elbow is not able to explore the entire search region in its full capacity, then there may be some regions remain untouched where the global optimal solution is locating. So for any population-based search algorithm, there must be some scenario and settings available to them so that it should explore the given search region in a very well scenario, so that it can see all the probable locations where our global optimal solution might be existing. So this velocity component in the velocity update equation, this actually, the diversification is controlled by this velocity component. And when you have located that this is the region where global optimal solution might be existing, then how to improve the quality of the solution? This phenomenon is governed by next two terms, which is the personal best component and the global best component. Means you have got to understand that this is the region, a small region where the or best or the optimal solution is locating, then how to improve the quality of the solution to locate that point, it is being done by the last two terms. So for a good particle swarm optimization algorithm, there should be a very good balance between diversification and intensification. Not only with PSO, if you are dealing with any population-based search algorithm, there should be a very good balance between diversity and intensity. Otherwise, if one of them is very high, then it will lead to a poor solution or a premature convergence. This is the same algorithm I already told you. This is the same flow chart. Okay, now come to the implementation portion where we'd like to see how we can implement this algorithm. So it starts, if you see the flow chart, it starts with the initialization of the particles or candidate solutions. So suppose if I wanted to create a random population between UB and LB and UB. LB stands for lower bound and UB stands for upper bound. So we can use this equation and this RAND function. This RAND function, I'm sure you must be aware. This is the way we use RAND function in MATLAB. In different programming language, we have a different keywords. But if you use LB, this must be UB minus LB, not LB minus UB.
I'm Ajit Laure.
Yes, please.
Sir, I want to ask you one question.
Please.
So here you have mentioned LB and UB, that is lower bound and upper bound.
Yes.
So suppose any system is there and LB and UB, we are defining for the decision variables. Okay.
Okay.
So how, if we don't know the exact parameters, means on what basis we'll have to mention the lower bound and upper bound? Say suppose any one controller it is there. I have designed that controller for any system. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But that decision variables of controller, absolutely I don't know. So
okay, I got your problem.
Yeah.
You mean to say that let me generalize this problem so that because we have a diverse participant, they can understand what you meant to ask. Suppose we have a function fx and we have to minimize it. It may be a problem of your domain, what you mentioned, and we don't know what is the range of x. This is what you are asking. So basically it is a part of problem modeling. It has nothing to do with PSO. See, PSO is going to work when your problem is modeled. Modeling of a problem, in that case, PSO is not going to be helpful. PSO can be applied only after when you have modeled your problem, you have well understood your problem, that this is the objective function which we have to minimize, and this is going to be your lower bound and upper bound. So without knowing these LB and UB, this PSO will not come into the picture. So what you asked to me, that is basically a problem of how you are defining or designing your problem. So that will totally, because it's a subjective thing again. And if you are choosing a particular area where you are modeling a problem as an optimization problem, then you need to understand its factors and aspects, that these are the decision variables, then where, what are the possible ranges of these decision variables. So that is totally on that particular domain knowledge. PSO cannot help to you how to figure out lower bound and upper bound unless until you design a problem, optimization problem, where you are going to look for the optimal values of LB and UB. Are you getting my thought? LB and UB, they are the identification of problem modeling. PSO cannot help in determining the LB and UB unless until you design a problem first as an optimization problem where you are going to get the optimal locations of LB and UB.
But sir, here in the initialization stage of your PSO, here also you have mentioned LB and UB. Okay. And multiplied by some RAND function available in the
matrix. Because we have already known to our objective function. This is that's why instead of, because ultimately they are going to be numbers or vectors. So that is why I have mentioned them by variable, because once you will identify your problem, then you will define your LB and UB accordingly. In this particular slide, this is just to understand how we will initialize. But what would be the numerical values of LB and UB that you need to determine while modeling your problem? I'll do a hands-on experience where I will solve a particular numerical example. There you can see how I'm choosing LB and UB. But for a different problem, it is a different scenario. It has to be dealt with the knowledge base of that particular problem domain.
But sir, there is no any fixed method for evaluating the LB and UB.
I'm afraid, because it's a problem domain. Means PSO is a tool. It is a tool to optimize a function, the primary work. But I can solve a problem only when there is a problem. If there is a problem which is not in its final form, I cannot solve it. So solution portion of any problem initiates only when the problem is formalized. It is already in its model. Then only we can talk about its solution. What you are asking, that how we can solve a problem, but problem do not exist. So my answer is, for this, first problem, model your problem, then PSO will come into the picture. PSO has nothing to do with modeling of the problem. I will explain a numerical example, then you will be very, very clear.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your question. If any one of you have similar queries, feel free to unmute and ask. There is no issue. Okay, so this, I was explaining this LB and UB. So by calling this equation, again, this is UB minus LB, not LB minus UB, just correct it. And this will generate a number between LB and UB. I will show you in MATLAB platform as well how we can do it. And if we wanted to generate a random matrix where all the entries must be between LB and UB, so we can use this array arrangement and it will do the same job. So this picture we already saw. Now, there are certain factors which I'd like to discuss. These are inertia weights. And what will happen when your particles are crossing the boundaries means they are going outside the search region. And when you need to clamp the velocity and what are the possible stopping criteria. So I will discuss one by one. So inertia weight. So by its name inertia, it is self-clear that it is actually that scalar multiple of velocity component, which I had mentioned with W, or in some literature, it is also mentioned as omega. So basically, whatever scalar value of omega or W you are picking, it actually provides a scalar multiple to W. If you make it very high, so it will give you a bigger value. If you make it small, it will give you a smaller value. So if the velocity value is small, then movement will be small in the candidate solutions. If velocity value is high, then movement will be high. So more or less, the inertia of any candidate solution is actually controlled by that factor W. And that is why we call it as the inertia weight. So if we wanted a bigger jump in a particular iterations, we need to keep the value of W very high. If we wanted a very small enhancements, then we need to keep the inertia weights very low. And restriction, I'll discuss later on. There are many possible ways. Not only we can keep it as a fixed value, we have other ways as well where we can have adaptive values or changing values of this inertia weight. Now the other problem which comes into the picture, suppose you are using PSO and what is happening after a certain number of iterations, particles are crossing the boundary. Because crossing the boundaries, mathematically, if I address it, it is kind of, they are going into infeasible region. Means they are becoming infeasible. So if a particle or solution becomes infeasible, then it is meaningless to us. So what we can do? We can bring back it to the search region by reinitializing it, or we can bring it back to the boundary of the region. These are two popular ways to address if the candidate solutions are becoming infeasible. Velocity clamping is needful because I already showed you velocity update equation is nothing but actually a recursive equation or a recurrence relation. And what is happening, it is keep on topping up their values and keep on increasing. So what will happen after a significant number of iterations, there may be a case that velocity value has become very large. So if velocity value has become very large, so it will provide a bigger jumps to the candidate solutions. And those jumps may be in such a way that they cross the search region. And in every iteration, what is happening? It is pushing the candidate solutions out of the region. And if it is happening, then algo is not doing well, because what is happening? It applies to the candidate solution and it becomes infeasible. So it's meaningless. In that case, we need to observe or figure out what are the velocity values after certain number of iterations. If they are becoming very, very large, we can multiply them by a factor 10 to the power minus 1, minus 2, minus 4. So it will moderate the velocity values and provide the lesser amount of jumps to the candidate solutions. This phenomenon is called the velocity clamping. And then stopping criterion. These are some popular stopping criterions. We can fix the maximum number of rotation. This is the most popular one. Fix an error tolerance. For example, suppose if you know that this is the global fitness value, and then you can make it a function when it achieves a certain level of error tolerance, it will execute. Or you can use the third phenomenon, where suppose after 100 or 200 number of iterations there is no improvement in the solutions, then it can execute. So one can use these stopping criterions separately, or one can use the combination of these stopping criterions for their algorithms. They will not only work for PSO, they work for all types of population based search algorithms. I had already discussed for the values of inertia weight and C1, C2. And now, what should be the optimal population size? Again, it's a subjective and experimental thing. It depends on the number of decision variables sometimes, and of course, the complexity of the problem. 20 to 40 number of candidate solutions are enough to locate the solution of any problem for which this PSO is doing well, because if you increase the swarm size significantly large, so it will enhance the complexity of the algorithm. Means then it needs to evaluate more function evaluations, and then it will be more time consuming, so complexity will increase. So again, this is a subjective thing, and you need to do some tuning and experimentation while choosing the swarm size. If you are dealing with 10 to 15 design variables, then 25 to 35 number of candidate solutions would be enough to use the PSO algorithm. This is just the guideline, not a fixed rule. Those who want to learn more in more detail and in more depth about PSO, there is a very good book written by Maurice Clark. He's a French engineer. He has written this particle sum optimization, and this book is freely available on web. Just Google it and you'll find its PDF. And it has discussed many more mathematical aspects of PSO, and their stability and convergence is also discussed. Those who are actually into to see the stability and convergence of PSO, it is there. So I recommend this book for those who really want to learn PSO in a very depth, not only from user point of view. And then as told you, the inertia weights have not only in literature, researchers used it as a constant value. It has been used as a variable value, or various phenomenon has been used, like random inertia weight, adaptive inertia weight, sigmoid function is used, linearly decreasing inertia weight. And you can see there are plenty of them available in the literature. One, if someone is dealing with a problem, if a certain inertia weight strategy is not working, there is a list, exhausted list of inertia weight strategies. It can be used and employed to get the better solutions. This is the certain comparison where I had compared what are the performances of certain type of inertia weight strategies. So far, what personally I feel, there have been very fancy inertia weight strategies, but the constant one is so far is the best one, or the relatively better one. Of course, it depends on problem to problem, but if I say statistically, then constant one is actually the best choice if you are doing with. Then over the years, people have come up with the various versions and variants of this PSO. They implemented many strategies into the PSO. I have listed few of them to improve the performance and ability optimization ability of particle swarm optimization scheme. And there are plenty of hybrid versions of PSO are also available. Initially, the first choice of hybrid with PSO was genetic algorithm. So I have collected this data where PSO has been hybridized with genetic algorithms to solve many real life engineering design problems for constant as well as constant optimization problems. You can see here power system, antenna design, multi-objective, alternator design, data clustering, document clustering, engineering design, neural networks. These hybrid versions of PSO and GA has been utilized in these types of problems. You can go and see in these papers in detail if you wish to use them or improve them or to work with them. Differential evolution is actually the next generation genetic algorithm kind of a scheme, which is I personally found very rich and strong optimization algorithm. And there are several hybrid versions of PSO with DEs also available in the literature, and they are also applied with different engineering design problems. The list are available here in terms of constant and unconstant optimization problems. And then if I talk about the applications of PSO, in almost all types of automation problems which exist in either whether it's an engineering, a design problem, or data problems, where you can model a problem in terms of an optimization problem, PSO has been used and utilized over the years by the researchers for discrete optimization problems, multi-model, power system, job shop scheduling, industrial optimization, cluster analysis, data mining, engineering design, the list goes on. So you can see with this existing literature how popular PSO and its hybrid versions used to be for solving various real life applications. So these slides are just to show that how promising PSO used to be over the years for solving many real life problems which cannot be solved using our classical methods like gradient descent or any other gradient based methods. So this was actually a PSO shrinking hypersphere based trajectory of particles in PSO. It was designed by myself, and it is actually a very strong variant of PSO. I think I would be preferring to focus some time in the implementation of PSO on MATLAB. So I just give you a hint. You can go and see it's this article. It's actually a good if I talk in terms of optimization ability of this version of PSO. So these are I'm skipping because well, I use some hypersphere concept to actually provide a very strong variant of PSO. And we did many theoretical analysis as well for how and why this PSO is actually doing well over certain types of problems. So all those things are available in that particular article. Okay, so this is the question one of you have asked just now, how to generate. See here, I am showing you the snapshots of this MATLAB command window, where I showed you how to generate a random number between two numbers LB and UB. So I just showed you, we can call this expression, this B means UB here and A means LB. B plus rand. Rand is a random number generator of MATLAB, which generates a random number between 0 and 1. So this is a numerical example where I wanted to generate a number between 2 and 3. So this LB, that is 2 plus rand into 3 minus 2. So it creates a random number between 2 and 3. Same thing we can do if we wanted to create a random matrix where each and every entry must lie in a certain interval. So it can be done in this particular way. Again, what would be the values for A and B? That's a thing which comes with the problem modeling. Before going to start with PSO, you should have this idea from the problem definition and formulation. What are these values? If you don't have, then you can start with guess. Sometimes it may work for your problem. And then I will explain briefly. I'm sure you must be already aware with these commands and keywords available in MATLAB, which are helpful for creating a very basic version of PSO for learning point of view. So before I go ahead, because now we are changing our gear again from theory to we are moving hands-on experience. If you got any question regarding theory so far we discussed, you can ask. Otherwise, we can do some hands-on experience and implementation. And those who have already MATLAB with them, they can do parallelly with me. I will provide them the entire code, which is already I have made available on MATLAB Central. So if any one of you have got any query so far in the theory of PSO, what I have discussed, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, I can move ahead. Okay, all right. I hope all goes well so far. So let us try to understand how we can create a very fundamental version of PSO for understanding point of view. Okay, so that you can really understand the implementation. So I'm going to use very simple commands available in MATLAB. By using them, I will create implement PSO algorithm in a easiest possible way so that one can understand. So this code particularly I designed just for learning point of view, so that if someone is scratching to learn PSO, it provides a basic level help to learn the implementation. So there are two commands, max and min, which are available in almost all programming languages. In MATLAB, we call them as a max and min. So if you have an array and if you call the max, if you pass that array into the max function, so what it will give? It will give you the maximum number or entry available in that particular array. But it has some hidden uses as well. For example, if I call it like this, b comma idx, idx here in I meant as an index. If you call this, what will happen? In B, it will store the maximum value, and in IDX, it will store the indexing, that at which location the maximum value is available. So 10 is the maximum value in this array, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and its indexing is 7th. So if I'm calling this max function in this way, so it will provide two things simultaneously: the maximum value as well as where it is located in the array. And the same thing we can do with the minimum value as well. If you call it, so it will store in the first argument, it will store the minimum value. In the second argument, it will store the location. These are the max min. They will be useful while we will be implementing the PSO code. And then there is a find function. So what this find does, this find function basically provides the locations where non-zero entries are there. Okay, so this array has entries 2, 4, 7, 9, 1, 7, 10, all of them are non-zero. So it is listing all the indices starting from 1 to 7. And in the second example, where we have indices 2, 4, the values at indices these 2, 4, 7, 9, 0, 7, 10, So if I pass this array into find function, so what it will list, it will list the locations where the non-zero values are there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, at fifth location there is a zero, so it is not in the B. So it will also be used for certain purpose to implement the PSO algorithm. And then this is the definition, mathematical definition of any optimization problem. So this is the most general way. It will be either maximize or minimize fx. If x has a single component, then it will be a single variable problem. Or if x has a many components, then it will be a multi-dimensional problem. And these design variables are basically stored in x. And then if there are certain constraints apart from lower bounds and upper bounds, then they can also be there. And then this problem will be called as a constraint optimization problem. If there are only lower bounds and upper bounds, then it will be an unconstrained optimization problem. And depending on the nature of fx, gx, and all these functions which I have mentioned here, it can be classified as a nonlinear programming, nonlinear optimization problem, or linear optimization problem. For example, if the nature of all these functions, fx, gx, are linear in nature, then it will be a linear programming problem. If they are nonlinear, then it will be a nonlinear problem. Okay, so now I'll take a very fundamental example where we will learn PSO, what I have explained so far, to understand how we can implement this PSO scheme for this function. So I am taking a simple example, which is summation xi square. Means it's like x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square and so on. It has a specific name as well. It is called sphere function. So we are going to minimize this function. We can observe it if you have a little mathematical idea. Its global minima is zero. And we are going to minimize this function using what PSO we have understood so far. So for this, I can show you this place. So this is my maths works page on MATLAB Central. Here I have shared many codes created by myself and my students. And here one of the fundamental one is the particle sum optimization for easy learning. So this you can simply go into the MATLAB Central. It may you may require to log in here and create an account, which is very easy. It only requires an email ID and password. And when you will log in, it will come and it will look like this. Once you will be logged in here in the MathWorks, or you can simply Google MATLAB Central, it will lead you to here. And in the search file, simply search my name Anupam Yadav, or simply particle sum optimization easy learning, and find the file exchange, search it, and you see this link will appear here. Just click on this link and then you will find the file. Those who can do right now, I recommend them to do it. So from this download link, you can download this toolbox or as a zip folder. So once you will download it, let me download it along with you. So you see it has got two files. One is PSO file in which the PSO algorithm is written, and one is the fitness function where we need to write the function which we are going to optimize. So let me open these files. I have already opened these files in my MATLAB platform. So let me show you one by one. So this is a fitness function. Those who are aware with the MATLAB programming and MATLAB function, you can easily create an objective function by creating this environment. So this is the same sphere function which I explained just now, which is summation I equals to 1 to n xi square. So x, that means x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square and so on. So what will happen whenever we'll pass a vector or an array into this function, it will simply evaluate its functional value. Okay, I can show you by an example. Let me change its view so that I can see the command window. Okay, this is default. So let me run this function again. Let me explain how it is written. It is simply defined a function and coded summation I equals to 1 to n xi square. It's very simple. Just download it, just watch it carefully. You will got to understand by using the sum function. So suppose if I run it, so naturally it will give an error because we don't have any input values. So suppose I am passing this value x equals to, let me take this value 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so in the fitness, if I pass this vector, you see it is providing 30, that is 1 square, because what I had passed 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square, 16 plus 9 plus 4 plus 1, that is 30. So whenever you will pass any array, this function is going to square the individual terms and sum it. And that is what we meant by sphere function. We can take one more example. If I take this time as a 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 2. And in the fitness, if I pass this double as x, it provides 9. So 4 plus 5, 9. So this is the place where you should put your objective function. Simple. If you wanted to create your own, simply replace this f by that function. It will work for your function as well. Now come to the another file that is written with the name pso.m. Okay. So I'll explain each and everything. This is a very small code. It won't take much time to understand and learn. So first I'll start with the certain initializers which will be required for implementing this algorithm. So the first is maximum number of iterations. Suppose I kept it 4000. It's again a user defined thing. You can choose a number of your choice. Then PS is a short form for particle size or population size. Help comments are already written here. You can understand the swarm size. So I'm going to take 20 candidate solutions. So the population size is 20. And I'm initializing the values of parameter values I already discussed. W as 0.9, C1 1.414, C2 as same 1.414, and an initializer for current iteration. So let us initialize this ITR equals to 1 means first iteration is initialized. And D stands for number of design variables. It is 5 here I have mentioned. Depending on your problem, you can change it, whatever number of design variables are available in your problem, which is you have defined in the fitness function. And then LB and UB. I have chosen here LB minus 5 and UB 5. If you wanted to minimize this sphere function in the domain minus 10 to 10, you can change it here. It will be minus 10 to 10, or whatever range you wanted to choose here, you can choose it. So these are certain initializers which were required to implement the algorithm: maximum number of iterations, swarm size, inertia weight, C1, C2 components, iteration initializer, number of design variables, lower and upper bound of the objective function or design variables. Now, the first step, initialization of the population. So you see, I have created a variable POS, which is a short form of position, which will store entire population. And I have used the same equation I have showed you in the slide, which is LB plus UB minus LB, RAND function it is called, P PS cross D means PS cross D. So it will create a matrix of size PS cross D where an individual row will be a candidate solution. Okay. Again, I'm repeating, it will create a matrix of size PS cross D and individual row will mention the existence of a candidate solution. And since there are PS rows, so total number of candidate solutions are PS, which we have mentioned here as 20. And then initialize the initial velocity, which we have discussed initially. So suppose initial velocity is zero, you can give it some non-zero value as well, but whatever value you give it, it doesn't matter much because over the time it manages by its own and it tunes itself by own. So there is no issue to start with zero. And then p-best, since it, so far we haven't carried out any iteration, so whatever population is available, each and every candidate solution is at its best. So the entire population is actually the personal best of its own. So p-best is initialized like passing the entirely generated population as POS. And after this, we are calling this fitness function, which we have created. So in this fitness function, what we are calling, we are passing this POS, means generated population. So I already showed you an example. Whenever this POS will pass, it will evaluate the fitness value of each and every candidate solution, and their fitness values will be stored in the variable fit. And then I'm using the min function, which I explained. And this array of fitness values are passed into min function. So the best fit will store the minimum value, and this IDX will store the indexing of that particular minimum value. And then GBS, GBEST, what will be, recall what was GBEST? GBEST was the best among the entire sort. So this IDX is actually having the index of that particle which is having the minimum value. So simply I'm calling that index from the entire population and it will be stored in GBEST. So in this way, we created personal best, global best, and we initialized the initial velocity, which is zero. Now main PSO algorithm will start working. So while ITR is less than maximum number of iterations, it will, means this while loop will run unless until we reach with the maximum number of iterations. And this velocity equation, the same velocity equation which I explained in theory session, and it is in the same way which I explained, it is written here, and it will calculate the velocity. And then the second one is the position update equation, which updates the position. So these, the first one is the velocity update and the second one is the position update. And then this is the arrangement which further identifies the personal best and global best. And then this is the arrangement. The first one is for the this one. If you carefully see, I'm not explaining it because it's simple programming. If you care, if you wanted to understand, just simply focus on the lines, how it has been written, you will get it easily. So this patch is for the updation of global best in every iteration. This patch is for the updation of personal best in every iteration. And this patch is written to keep entire population in the specified search region. And that's all. This is all PSO has. And you can run it. For example, I'm running a sphere function whose minimum value is zero. So let me run it and let's see what solution it gives. So you see, in no time it ran and it is giving this value. G best fit value is 1.54 10 to the power minus 50, which is very near to zero, and its location. So in this way, you can understand this implementation of PSO. If any one of you have downloaded and are trying to execute, if you face any problem, let me know. I can address. And if you got any questions, you can ask. So I think we can have now a query session where I'll be answering your queries.
I'm audible.
Yes, yes, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Sir, myself, Abhinav Sharma from UPS Dehradun. I'm having a question. While I'm using this particle sum optimization or any other optimization technique in my research problem, whenever I am running the algorithm, I'm getting different results. So which result to consider as a final result?
See, if every time you are getting a different result and if those results are entirely different.
Right. They are different, but they are approximately close.
They are approximately close. Then what you need to do? Different. What things are different? There are two things. Right. Because if you carefully see this code, so there are two things in the output. Right. One is the objective function value, which is this one, and another is their decision variable values.
Right. So, I'm talking in terms of the fitness value as well as the position value.
As well as position. So I'll take both one by one.
Right.
If you are getting objective function value slightly different in different experiments.
Yes.
Then, but they are not very much different.
Right, right.
It means your algo is able to get the desired level of accuracy, but I believe you should increase more number of iterations.
Okay.
Okay. Then what will happen? Then it will intensify and locate the best possible which can be discovered by PSO. Okay. If it is giving nearby different values of objective function value, you should increase the number of iterations, or you can enhance a bit in the population size as well. Now come to the decision variables.
Okay.
In decision variable, it will depend what type of problem you are solving. If your problem has only a unique global optimal solution, then it should not give entirely different values in every experiment. Okay. It should give on a line of its fitness value. Like you are getting this value, and if you rerun, you are again getting a similar range of design variables. But this will be possible only in that case when your problem has a unique optimal solution. There may be a scenario that your problem has multiple global optimal. So in that case, your fitness value will remain same, but your design variable values may be different.
Okay.
Are you getting my problem?
Right.
Means suppose your function has the same minimum at two different points. You can see like a function of sine x. So it has a same minima at different points. So if your problem has multiple minimas, then you getting a different design variable values, this is natural.
Okay.
But you need to check your problem.
Sir, I've read some papers, research articles. They have written that these are all the stochastic techniques. They are stochastic. That's why what they have done, they have taken the mean and the median of the solutions in certain number of runs. They have considered 30 runs. And in those 30 runs, the solution that they are getting, they are taking its mean value, median value, and accordingly, they are quoting that this is the final result, the median or the mean value.
See, these algorithms are stochastic, very true, and they do not guarantee for providing the global optimal solution.
Right.
So once they are not guaranteeing, then we need to stick with the statistical performance. It's like you are running algorithm 100 times and 100 times. If it is discovering the same result, then the research community then accepts it. And before doing that, because PSO, D or any algorithms, whenever they have been coined, they have been tested on certain benchmarks,
right,
which are extremely difficult. And statistically, there it has been shown that out of 30 runs or 100 runs, they are 100 times or 99 times, they are able to get the solutions. So whether your scheme is providing you the final global optimal solution or not, this is always a questionable thing. What you can at max do, you can rely on statistical performance. If statistically it is doing similar thing again and again, not fluctuating, then you can believe that result.
So we should consider the statistical parameters while giving us the final results, quoting us the final result, right?
You can take, for example, suppose you carried out 100 times the same experiments and you are taking the median value of this is also a kind of culture people follow, but right. It's you, whatever it feels you that this is the good, you should choose and declare that one as the best.
So because the problem that I'm considering is parameter extraction of solar PV cells. So in that, the parameters that they are for the functions of fifth dimension and seventh dimension. So in that, the values that the parameters are having, they were at a very, very much 0.00015 such type of value. So in that case, it is very difficult to analyze the results because of the very small value. That's why
in terms of fitness value or design variable?
No, design value, design parameters value, not the fitness value, parameter. The
parameter values.
Right. The agents that we are considering in PSO.
No, it's nothing like, suppose I am getting a value 1.2 into 10 to the power minus 50.
Right.
It depends what is the unit of that parameter. If that unit is light years, then it's a very big value.
Okay.
And if that unit is centimeter, then that value is very small. So it depends on your problem that whatever parameters you are dealing with, what are their units?
Right.
So if it is a small number, then whether it's a small or bigger number, it can only be determined when its unit is known.
Okay.
So it's not like 0.002 is, then it's a negligible. It's negligible only if it is kilometer.
Okay. Sir, one more question. What I have done, I have taken the 30 runs, right, for estimating my result as the as has been done in the papers, right? Now, what I am doing when I am taking 30 runs in, I am running the code in MATLAB, and then I am getting the result. Then again, when I am running next 30 runs, suppose I am repeating the same 30 runs again, then the value is different. Now, when I'm stopping my MATLAB, I'm closing the MATLAB and again opening the MATLAB, then the first time the result that I'm getting, that is the same. So some memories remain, some values remain in the memory. That's why.
No, it's not like that. You should just try to learn the seed management or seeding phenomenon in MATLAB, because the random number generator which used by MATLAB is actually nothing is like totally random. They are some function. There is certain level of bias. So what you can do, just make it a function of time. Okay. You can just, there is a keyword seed. Okay. You just Google seed management, you will get to know how to address seeding. Okay. Make that seed management as a function of machine clock. Okay. So machine clock is every time different.
Okay.
So if your random number generator is a function of time, then you will every time, there is a good, very good chance that you will every time get a unbiased population. It will not follow the previous one.
Okay.
This is, you can try. Because these seeding, actually these random number, we call them random number generator, but they are not actually ideally random number generator. They have certain level of bias. And this can be used to avoid this.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions. I think we had one more
sir, question. Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, I am Leela Krishna speaking from RVRJC College of Engineering, Guntur, sir. Suppose in my problem, if there are n variables and they are having different bounds, upper bounds and lower bounds, then how to incorporate in the code which is given by you? Can you please?
You can do this. It's not difficult. You see the here. There is a. Can you see this screen?
Yeah, I am able to see.
I have mentioned LB minus 10 and UB 10. So it means whether I have 5 variables or 10 variables, all of them have the same lower bound and upper bound. If you have different, if you have different, then it's not a problem. You can place an array here. For LB, you can define, suppose first design variable, it is minus 10. Second design variable, it is minus 5. Third design variable, it is minus 1. And similarly, suppose we have only 3 design variables. And similarly, here you can go with, suppose it is 10, it is 6, it is 7. Okay?
Okay, sir.
This way you can do. And then in this generation thing, you need to again rewrite it so that this matrix multiplication remain valid. Okay?
Okay, in my problem, if there are some constraints, so then how
there
to...
are constraints, then first you need to learn the constraint handling mechanism. There are certain, you can use the penalty based method, or you can use the, there is a very good idea which frequently I follow, that is calculating the infeasibility rate. Because in this session I was focused on only unconstraint, but dealing constant is not a big deal in PSO. You can either look for the implementation of how to use the penalty based methods for handling the constraints, or infeasibility based method. Both are available in the literature. Even you can find their codes as well. They are not very difficult to implement. By using them, you need to just create the constraints, and it can be used. It's not a problem.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Hello, sir.
Leela Krishna.
Sir, I am only recently I have asked a question.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Sir. Hello.
Yes, Mr. Ajit.
Yes, sir. Actually, I have executed your code for the
yes.
PSO just now on my MATLAB on the computer. So I'm getting here that objective function values and all that. Okay. And 5 decision variables values I'm getting as a column vectors.
Okay.
So by only judging that values, which are presented as a column vectors. So how I can judge the global optima it has been reached or not?
See, the problem which is written in this particular example, this is sphere function, and it's we know that it's a mathematical function. We know that its minimum value is 0. We already know it, and it is giving us the result very near to 0. It is 10 to the power minus 50 is almost 0.
Yes.
So this is acceptable for this particular problem. But if you are coming up with the different problem, or where you have no idea about the solution of the problem, then you need to carry out experiments many and many times. You need to see in literature if there is any idea given about the solution of that particular problem. Otherwise, whatever it is discovering, that would be the best solution given by this scheme.
Yeah, I do agree with you, sir. But by just observing that readings, okay, how we come up to know that whether global optima it has been reached or not? Means whatever solutions we are getting, that may be trapped in the local optima, or that may be trapped in the global optima. So how we can decide ki I'm getting the global optimal solution?
So for that, you need to have the idea of the problem, because for this particular problem, we have idea that if it is, because we know the global optimal solution is at 0, 0, 0. So this is, we are getting the value 0, 0, 0. So we are sure that in this particular case, it is not trapped in the local minima. But if you are come up with a totally random new problem where you don't have any idea about the complexity and whether it's a multiple solution or a single solution, then you need to do experimentation, and you can use many more algorithms to do. If all of them are discovering the similar results, then you can find it as an optimal solution. Means then you can understood like, so far we have the best, this is the available. Someday any another researcher may come with a different algorithm, and if it has got more accurate result, then it may be that your results were not that much good. But if the problem is totally unknown, we don't have any idea about the landscape or the problem solution, then whatever solution it is providing, we need to rely on that. Means you need to figure out other means to verify whether these solutions are actually acceptable or not, and that those means will rely on that problem definition and problem domain.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, this is Dr. Abhangshudas calling from NIT Agartala. So
yes,
actually,
please.
My research domain is multi-objective optimization using genetic algorithm and non-dominated sorting, as well as Pearson. All these algorithms actually uses the iterative approach. So can we change the termination criteria?
Sorry, can you repeat? I'm actually, your voice is breaking. Either you just type or just can you say it again so that I can listen.
Hello.
Yes, now I can hear you.
Okay, sir. My question is, can we change our termination criteria for the algorithm from the iterative based termination criteria to any other method?
I already explained two more methods.
Happen. It may possible that I have given the iteration of 2000. It may possible that at 2001 may I get a better solution. Okay. So is there any other method we can change this termination criteria for this algorithm?
Yes. See, first thing is, you need to carry out some experiments. Like you mentioned, 2000 iterations. So 2000 iterations may be less or maybe far more. Depends on what problem you are solving. So when you are solving a problem, then you need to carry out the iterations, or you need to fix maximum number of function evaluations. And what would be that value that you need to carry out for different experiments. For example, you try for 2000, 3000, 4000. And what personally I have feel, when you carry out these experiments, then you will clearly get to understand, after following the convergence trajectory of best solution in every iteration, that after certain number of iteration, there is no improvement in the solution. And when there is no improvement in the solution, then you can choose that up to this level of iteration is enough. This is one of them. And another way is, you can randomly choose any maximum possible number suitably, not very big number. And then you can fix that if after, suppose 200 iterations, suppose your algo works for 1000 iterations, results were updating, you were improving. But suppose after 200 iterations, nothing is improved. So you can fix this kind of criterion as well. You fix 10,000 iterations as a maximum number of iteration. Along with this, put one more condition, that if sequentially in 200 iteration or 300 iteration, if the results are not improving, then algo should stop evaluating further. These are the popular ones which people use.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Or if you know the global optimal value of fitness value, you can make it as a error tolerance, that problem should work unless until you achieve this level of accuracy, say 10 to the power minus 5, minus 10, or whatever you wish to mention.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, what is the process of hybridizing TSO with some other algorithm?
When it comes to hybridization, then it's not a standard thing. Someone is hybridizing, it means someone is spinning its own idea that how I'm going to use this PSO or any another algorithm together. So there are many, there is no standard way. I can answer what are the popular ways. So the popular ways are sometimes people divide the population. People divide the population like that. If suppose there are 60 candidate solutions in the swarm. So what I'll do, 30 I will iterate with PSO and rest of the 30 I will iterate with genetic algorithm or any another algorithm. This is one of the idea. Another idea could be first 5,000 iterations I'll execute with PSO. Then whatever solution finally I'll get, I'll take them as an initial solution for the another algorithm. So these kind of methods people have been used, or sometimes people make it a random function that some threshold value will be defined. If it is crossing this value, then it will randomly choose whether I have to use PSO or GA. So these are some popular ways which I explained people use for hybridize. But there is no standard way for hybridization. You can think in any way if it is working well.
Okay, so thank you, sir. Sir, again, what is the way to modify PSO? Because in many literature, people have suggested modify this algorithm or improve this algorithm like this. What is the,
for modifying, see, if you have carefully followed this session, then you need to not only PSO, let's make it more general. If you are trying to modify any population-based algorithm, so first you need to go into its structure and try to observe what are the factors which are actually helping it to work in a desired way. First, you need to identify those factors. Then you can think of, can we upgrade or change these factors so that the performance can be improved. These are the possible gateways to derive or provide a modified version of any population-based search algorithm. The idea could be anything, but the key way is try to figure out what are the performing factors which are leading that particular algorithm, and then try to see those key factors. They could be anything, like in PSO, it will be a personal best influence, or how the particles are interacting, what topology we are following for creating the connections. Just identify what are the governing key factors, and those key factors, if you modify and if they are doing well, then you can come up with the modified versions.
Okay, thank you.
I believe that's all. Dr. Vivek.
Yes, sir. I think it's all now. Thank you very much. Aditya?
Yes,
sir. Aditya? Yes, please continue.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. Say a bit loud.
Thank you so much, sir, for gracing us with your presence and such an insightful session. I am sure that everyone present here must have learned a lot from you. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me, Dr. Vigas. We have, I think, one more session day yes, after sir. Tomorrow. Yes. And at that day, I'll be explaining one of the very recent algo, artificial electric field algorithm, which is designed by myself and which is nowadays becoming slightly popular. So the way we learn today PSO, we'll try to learn artificial electric field algorithm in the next session. Yes, so sir, it's not finished. We have just suspended the session. We'll connect in the next session again.
Definitely.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir, for mentioning that. I was just about to mention the same thing, that sir has another session coming up on Thursday, the 22nd of July. It's a session from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. about the artificial electric field algorithm and its applications to graph matching. And we have another session coming up, the fifth session from 3:30 to 5:30.